Good afternoon and good morning to you, to where you may be. Welcome to another webinar. Today we'll be discussing the topic of building a robust M&E systems, incentives to use M&E information. My name is Parfait Kasongo and I am the communications and learning coordinator for Twendembele. So just to some quick house rules or webinar rules, keep yourselves muted at all times. Keep your videos off at all times. We will have a question and answer session after all our presenters or speakers get to speak. If you do have any questions, would you kindly place them in the chat box below as indicated on the graphic. I would like to very quickly introduce you to our facilitator and speakers. Our facilitator is Ms. Karen, and she is the divisions manager at the Independent Development Evaluations in the African Development Bank. And then we have our first presenter, Mr. Timothy, who is the Commissioner for Monitoring and Evaluations in the Office of the Prime Minister in Uganda. And then we have Mr. Andrew, who is the Chief M&E Technical Advisor at the Ministry of Monitoring and Evaluations in Ghana, followed by Stanley, who is the Chief Director at the Department of Planning, Monitoring and Evaluations in South Africa. So as mentioned earlier on, Ms. Karen will facilitate our conversation. Karen, the floor is yours. If you just guide this conversation, please.
Okay, thank you very much, Parfait. And welcome to all of the participants. So this webinar is brought to you by Twendembele. Twendembele is a peer learning partnership among six African governments, the governments of Benin, Ghana, Kenya, Niger, South Africa, and Uganda. And the purpose of the partnership is to strengthen national monitoring and evaluation systems, to promote performance and accountability of governments towards their citizens for service delivery. Now, these countries voluntarily collaborate on various expert aspects of strengthening their monitoring and evaluation systems by learning from each other on what has worked and what has not worked, and applying that knowledge in their own country context. Some of the aspects on which the countries are currently collaborating include performance management tools, evaluation methodologies like rapid evaluations, making monitoring and evaluation systems more gender responsive, and engaging better with civil society. So this partnership really puts monitoring and evaluation at the center of sound governance arrangements. We believe that monitoring and evaluation are necessary for the achievement of good quality evidence-based policymaking, budget decisions, management, and accountability. And the issue of utilization of monitoring and evaluation information is central to performance and sustainability of the system. But simply having M&E information available does not necessarily guarantee that it will actually be used, whether by program managers in their day-to-day work, by budget officials responsible for advising on spending options, or by parliaments who are responsible for holding the government accountable and performing oversight. So we're here to discuss today the incentives to using M&E information. What are some of those incentives in the different countries? Why do we think that strengthening the incentives will lead to better and greater government accountability and better performance? those are some of the topics that we're here to discuss. So I will first give the floor to Andrew from Ghana to provide his perspectives on this question. Thank you.
So what are the preconditions? I'll start with this question. What are the preconditions for, encouraging utilization of M&E information? And I think we need to start from that point, because more often than not, M&E people come in at the tail end of a project or a project, and are tasked to assess the effectiveness of the project in terms of, there are various dimensions. You look at the design, its relevance, its implementation, the challenges, and then the efficacy and the sustainability, lessons learned, and all that. And most of the time, the M&E officers were not part of the design of the program or the project. And so you come in, and if it's well designed, you may have an easier task of understanding it and being able to evaluate it and packaging the findings in a way that that is usable. But most of the time, at least in the public sector sphere, it's not as straightforward as that. In the public sector, and in our current democratic dispensation, parties campaign on their manifestos, and if they are lucky, they get elected. In the case of our country, then they start implementing what they have promised in their manifestos. And more often than not, at least the experience we've had when the Ministry of Monitoring and Evaluation was established was that, there were a whole list of programs. And most of these programs, there were no concept notes, to guide us. So we had to develop what we call the government resource framework. And that helped a little bit. So I think, a key element in having a robust M&E system which will produce evidence that can be used is really to understand or to be part of the design, where you work with other colleagues to understand the problem that a project is designed to solve. And so you will be part of defining the DO, the development objective, and then identifying the key activities, the outputs, and then the expected outcomes, and then translating these into a framework. First of all, you may have to do the theory of change, where you define the critical paths that would deliver the expected results, and then set up the system that will allow you to track, and report on a systematic basis. Short of being part of the design, I think it becomes a real challenge. Because coming in from the cold can be quite intimidating, depending on what the expectation is, and then you need to have a critical mass of people who know what they are doing in terms of having will be used to to assess a program or a project, and then packaging the findings in a way that can be accessible to policymakers, program and level, which is a much higher level, is really, is there demand, you know, because most of the time evaluation is supply driven. And so you have bodies in ministries, departments, or agencies that are supposedly doing M&E, you know. So it's heavily dependent on the supply, but the information that we are collecting, you know, is it just meeting a certain legislative requirement, that's, or is there a deliberate attempt or effort to drive demand so that whatever you prepare in terms of reports will be shared and the findings used. So, you know, where the challenge has been is generating the demand for evidence. And I think in Ghana, because the Ministry of Monitoring Evaluations was created as an executive instrument, and in fact, initially was part of the Office of the President, I think right from the beginning, we seem to have had access, you know. And luckily for us also, our minister was made a member of cabinet as well as a member of the economic management team, which is headed by the vice president. So that access helped in terms of the products that we produced. We were able to channel them through our minister to cabinet. So that demand has been there and has been very useful. So you know, the robust M&E system really should be driven by supply and demand, but not only supply. And that you also have on the demand side, you need a critical mass of, or at least a champion, you know, who will be able to carry forward, the messages and the reports and so on. I think I'd like to stop here. Hello.
Yes, okay, thank you very much, Andrew. So we may have some questions for you later, specifically on what are incentives in Ghana for using M&E. Perhaps you have some examples that you could share with us, but we'll come to that later. Let me first hand over to Timothy Lubanga, the Commissioner for Monitoring and Evaluation in Uganda. Timothy, you have the floor.
Thank you, Karen, who's the chairperson and moderator of this webinar. Greetings to you, warm greetings from Uganda, and also to my fellow panelists and all the participants who have joined in. I see they have joined in from different parts of the continent and even different parts of the world. Greetings from Uganda. So the first area I'm going to share with you is on what is M&E information in our context. So what do we mean by M&E information in the Ugandan context? So in our case, basically, this includes findings on performance, and we do performance assessment at various levels and in various ways. But in this slide, I summarize what constitutes the biggest component or elements of sources of M&E information in the Ugandan context. The first is we do assess how government policies are implemented, and that is through the regular monitoring, but also periodic evaluations that we do of many government policies. The recent evaluations that we have done, for example, are on employment policy. We have done evaluations of the partnership policy. We did an evaluation of the procurement policy and so on, just to mention but a few. So that is one major source of our M&E information. The other is, of course, we assess performance of government programs and government strategies. That's in the public sector, that's a very big element of M&E and a big source of M&E information in the Ugandan context. Across the country, in the private sector, in the civil society, there are lots of projects and interventions, both private government and non-government interventions that are implemented. And there are different monitoring activities that go on almost in every project, whether it's by civil society, an NGO, private sector, or government. And so there are many, many M&E evaluation reports and so on that can be found across the different levels. And then we also assess government institutions. How are institutions performing? Ministries, departments, government agencies. We did an evaluation of public sector organizations in the country, which informed a major reform in the country. So that's another. And then we have other sources, for example, the human resource monitoring system, service delivery, and so on. So the second issue, which is a bigger part of what I want to share with you this afternoon, is how is this M&E information used in our context? And so I will describe, categorize in about five or so ways how we broadly, and I'll try to share with you in detail what happens. And then I will summarize by developing the presentation and arguments by Andrew from Ghana on what are some of the incentives, and you'll see some similarities and complementarity. So the first, I think, very important use of M&E information in the country is prioritization. And prioritization is a major issue because, as you know, public resources are scarce. And so you need to make choices. You need to make choices. Economists speak about this quite a lot. And so we use the evidence that we generate from our M&E work to make these decisions. Yesterday, for example, we launched the first meeting of this year's Parliamentary Advisory Committee on the Budget, popularly known as PACOP. And this is an important committee which ensures that the views and voices of members of parliament from the ruling party, who are the majority in our case, that the views and interests and priorities of the ruling party and of members of parliament are included in the budget for next financial year. This is a very important use of M&E for in our case. And as I speak now, all the staff in my directorate are busy doing secretarial work to the different subcommittees of this. So this is a huge important influence of M&E information. But for prioritization, we also see the work that is done by the Equal Opportunities Commission and validating work plans across government. The National Planning Authority does what we call a compliance assessment to assess how sector and ministerial plans are aligned to the National Development Plan. And what they actually use is the evidence generated from M&E. We also have a big activity here on monitoring the implementation of the Sustainable Development Goals. And what we do is we are using our performance information on not just the alignment, but also on the implementation of SDGs to prioritize what sectors plan in subsequent years. The second major area is for planning and budgeting. And this is hugely, hugely important, not just in government, but also in non-government organizations. The number one or at least one of the key sources of information that influences planning on a quarterly basis, on a 6-monthly basis, in an annual basis, or information from your previous monitoring and evaluation work. And so in our case, preparation of program implementation action plans, for example, which is ongoing at the moment, is hugely informed by the evidence and the findings or the results of the performance of various institutions last year, and that's in the public sector. But for every project or every NGO, if you look at their planning activities, they benefit a lot from the lessons that they have from implementation of their programs in the previous or past seasons. And that is, in my view, a very big use of M&E information. The other use is resource allocation. Now, this is also an important area, and we want to promote this a little bit more. So in our case, we undertake what we call a local government performance assessment. And for those who are familiar with our dissemination activities, we publish this in the media. And this provides a ranking of how local governments perform. And what it does is that it serves to influence the amount of resources in terms of conditional and unconditional grants that are allocated to a district in the subsequent year. And that is a huge motivation. But also for the justification of projects for all public investments that are approved by the development committee are actually ranked based on evidence on good performance in the past seasons. Now, there are a few other very important areas where we use M&E, and I'll just run through in 1 minute or so. The first one is accountability. Everybody who is in leadership and in public office or even management of private business would like to provide accountability. And so M&E is a huge, huge instrument for providing accountability, especially for public resources. We are pushing for performance contracts to be based on performance of a manager or a leader. And this is an area that we are going to now implement under the National Development Plan. But a very good justification for how the decision is made on renewing of performance contracts of persons in leadership is an important use. Reviewing policies and programs, providing public pressure and program implementation. Karen, I think I have maybe 2 minutes or so, and I will just quickly run through the incentives. So what are the incentives we have to use M&E? The first and most important incentive, I would say, is the desire by Parliament and the political leadership to influence the budget. And I have already explained an example of the Parliamentary Committee on the Budget. But on the political leadership particularly, every party, every government wants its agenda to be implemented. And so they want to influence the agenda of the budget. And that's a huge incentive for them to use evidence to demonstrate where they are doing well, but also to influence where prioritization should take place. The second is public pressure for accountability. We have an active media, and I think globally or in the continent, we see a huge growth in the influence of the civil society and lobby groups and donors and so on. And so the incentive to use M&E to respond to pressure for accountability is in our view and in our experience, a strong one. I have already explained a lot on resource allocation. So as a public officer, I have the desire to influence power, to have more influence, more power, to increase my space. And so in that way, I will be able to generate additional resources. For the non-government organizations as well, that's an important area. Karen, I think I have come to the end of my presentation, and I thank all the participants for listening and look forward to your comments and also your questions. Asante-san.
Thank you very much, Timothy. Exactly on time. So we're now going to go to Stanley in the Department of Planning, Monitoring and Evaluation in South Africa to share the South African experience. Stanley, you have the floor.
Thank you, Karen, and good day to you. Good day to the host, Parfait, fellow presenters, Timothy and Andrew, and all colleagues who are joining us from different parts of the continent. My approach, can you go to the next slide, is to really share the journey at a macro level of the evolution of the South African government-wide M&E system since about intensively really 2008 or 2004, but I will also cover periods from 1994. As you know, the new polity or the state as it is, it's a fairly new democracy, and hence we are so keen to learn from others who have been through this journey for more decades. So these three major waves that I've demarcated, and then I will then draw lessons at the end. Next slide, please. Yeah, the slides are quite weighty, and that's deliberate, because I thought sometimes you start speaking here and then your voice disappears. But of course, the slides will be shared. In short, we have a first wave from around 1994, where the focus was on state building and reconstruction. So M&E was just seen as a good policy for transparency and accountability. So the major preoccupation had less to do with the establishment of systems and even embedding it in projects. But at the constitutional level, there are values that were embedded in the constitution, which are like, for example, transparency is big, accountability, issues of participatory governance, efficiency and effectiveness, especially if you go to chapter 10 of the constitution, it actually has all these key objectives of a typical M&E system. And what also is unique is the fact that that constitution provided for a set of bodies that are called constitutional bodies in chapter 9, which Human Rights Commission, you have all those commissions, including the Office of the Auditor General. And evidence in the main that was used to assess progress in service deliveries from official statistics, research, and so on and so forth. Can you go to the next slide? It still talked to the same thing. Here, I just wanted to make a point. One of the practices that is done from a central level in South Africa is the reviews that broadly covering the state of affairs over a period of time, usually every 5 years. The first one, can you go back there? Second slide. Yes. So a critical milestone was that first review that recommended. What was interesting is the fact that you have to recognize that you have to invest in M&E. It's not something that we say a lot these days, but that commission for us was very clear and made a very good point that the cost incurred pale the comparison to those of continued implementing ineffective and cost inefficient programs, which can be harmful as well. That's the point Andrew also raised of the design. So M&E is really vital. And in there, then there were seeds that were laid for establishing a government-wide M&E system, which in 2004 we then did a 10-year review, which informed the design of a government-wide M&E system, which was a partnership among many transversal agencies within the state and with think tanks and academia. And one of the products we used to generate then was the development indicators, which sourced administrative data from across many sectors. Next. The second wave is since around 2009, when then we graduated from a unit, which was in the policy unit in the presidency, where then globally, you had that recognition that political leadership, both in parliament and executive, have to play a role on the demand side of M&E. One experience that was quite well known was the Tony Blair government and what it did in terms of driving a results-based M&E system, drawing academics into the government system to assist with the use of evidence. So countries like Malaysia and ourselves followed through then to do outcomes-based approach. And now, whilst before, the E of M&E was really a small one, so there wasn't much really done on the evaluations. So the demand for deeper analysis to understand whether programs are performing and whether they are making any difference then led to the establishment of the evaluation system. So critical in that regard is also benchmarking with others so that you don't have to spend the same time in terms of designing the systems that are already existing in Ghana, in Uganda, where there have been iterations over the years to be where they are. So that was crucial for us to do that benchmarking. We also had that a major workshop in 2012 where it was a catalyst, for example, for knowing that Benin and Ghana and Uganda are actually pursuing the same strategy as South Africa in terms of the national evaluation system driven at a transversal level from the central ministry, either in the presidency or office of the prime minister. And of course, partnerships, very useful in that regard. Next. Then the third wave is the more recent period where after we have produced the National Development Plan in 2012, it wasn't really implemented until there was a need to realign it or, with the Monitoring and Evaluation Ministry. So they were merged into one. And the new questions then arose in that regard of long-term planning and all of that. And how do you then start focusing on driving big societal trying to address big societal problems. We have what we call triple challenges of unemployment, poverty, and inequality, and all of that. So it's still a preoccupation. The evaluation system was institutionalized, impaired monitoring, management performance assessment tool, highly valued by parliament because there you are assessing policy. So parliament loves what would talk to their mandate of lawmaking and citizen engagement. So those instruments are very useful, especially citizen feedback as well. Next one. Now, this is the contemporary period that builds on this third wave, which has been actually, I think COVID-19 has become a big, a prominent event in our journey of managing state affairs. And one of the studies that emerged out of the IMF recently, it talks about the vicious cycle of how pandemics lead to economic despair and social unrest. And that's the challenge we're facing now. And the new questions that are emerging, that's the last sentence there, is to provide more impact analysis, recommend solutions to saving lives and livelihood, develop new models, and really the agility of the M&E system is being challenged. The case study of the health sector is a useful one in our case, given this is a public health crisis. This is one of the systems that have been over the decades, literally even predating 1994, but mainly then as an information management system that reaches up to the front line, when nurses are actually punching data into the system that feeds into a provincial and national system. So that system has been tested to the limit, but it has responded quite well. And the network that exists in that sector of science council, laboratories, academia, civil society, and very close collaboration with the World Health Organization has really strengthened how we are responding, with that health system being at the center of how monitoring and evaluation is done for COVID-19. Last slide. So these are the reflections which really align closely to what Timothy shared and Andrew. Safe to emphasize the fact that if you see M&E in the context of a macro level of government, you have to locate it in the public sector reform agenda. Otherwise, the moment you see it as one thing that is separate from that, it runs the risk of being seen outside of what government seeks to achieve. Both colleagues have emphasized, for example, the role of political principles in parliament and in the executive. See it as an executive instrument. So those who know, some decade or so, two decades ago, it was unheard of. You think you were worried more about political interference and all of that, without realizing that policymakers do actually have to have this information. So make them to be champions at an institutional level. You must have specific entities that drive this monitoring and evaluation agenda. There was a question on the notice board about units in the sectoral level. So those are also important. In fact, as in management practice, it should be part of every project and a program, but then as how the bureaucracy of government works, units then are very important in the ministries and departments. Number seven, on the capacity development side, which deals with both the supply side and stimulating demand, it's very important to target many role players. And in here, I'm emphasizing the issue of partnerships globally. You reap more benefits when you learn from others, so that you don't spend too much time on what that it might have taken them years to build, but because it works, they can tell you what works and works well. Hence, I love knowledge sharing platforms like this one. And also with civil society, with donor community and in private sector, and build that network through the voluntary organizations for evaluators, like in our case, it's AMEA, in our African continent, it's AFREA. And of course, I will not stop to champion Twendembele as well, as a network that helps with that. So that's my take on this. I hope that does make sense. Ndiyabulela. Those are some of the 9 official languages in South Africa. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Stanley. And thank you to all 3 presenters. I already see a number of questions appearing in the chat. They are very welcome. I've already noted a number on having a separate M&E ministry, on champions, on evaluation by parliaments. So let me just group a couple of these questions. And so the first question is on having a separate M&E ministry. So there's a question specifically to Andrew, but I think I'm going to direct it to Stanley as well. So it's interesting that Ghana has a fully fledged ministry of monitoring and evaluation. And the participant is saying that in Kenya, they've been having heated debates in Kenya on whether it is more effective to have a separate M&E ministry or having M&E departments in all ministries. So he would like to hear the experience and perspective of Andrew on the advantages of having a separate M&E ministry. I'm also going to put the question to Stanley because, of course, DPME is also a separate ministry.
Okay, so thank you very much. I think our experience is unique in the sense that in addition to the Ministry of Monitoring and Evaluation, there is also a government agency, the National Planning, the National Development Planning Commission, which has a mandate to undertake evaluations. But then they sort of got themselves into sort of meeting a legislative requirement by preparing annual reports that were submitted to Parliament, and nothing happened after that. Yesterday we had a sort of a reflection on the journey so far in terms of, you know, the establishment of the ministry and how, you know, whether we've had any impact in the policy sphere. And we realized that, of course, to step back, we didn't know the calculations that went into the establishment of the ministry. But what is certain, though, is that we were given a minister who has a lot of experience. And as I indicated earlier, he sits in cabinet as well as sits on the economic management team. So the work of the ministry has been just in time. And we focus mainly on specific flagship programs which we track and report to cabinet. So it's really an executive. The Ministry of Monitoring and Evaluation is an instrument for the executive to track its priority programs. And so that's what it is. But in doing that, we've had to collaborate with the ministries, the main ministries. We have about 33 ministries. And what we did was to form a network of heads of M&E units in what we call the MDAs, ministries, departments, and agencies. And they have been central in supporting the work of the ministry. Because, I mean, otherwise, coming in from the cold, you know, it's a new ministry. We didn't, we're not part of the public sector service architecture. It would have been very difficult, but because we set up the network and we, you know, sort of build a community of practitioners, M&E practitioners, it really helped. First of all, when we decided to do a government resource framework that covered the period of the current government in power, which is 2017-2020. They were quite instrumental because then the president asked each minister to identify some priorities, three priorities, as a matter of fact, and putting the resource framework together and subsequently in tracking progress of the government flagship programs. So, in short, the Ministry of Monitoring and Evaluation works closely with the other ministries, and actually by having a central ministry, they are able to channel their reports to cabinet in a way which didn't exist before. So I'm not sure whether I've done justice to the question, but I'd like to pause if other questions. Thank you very much for the question.
Okay, thank you, Andrew. Stanley, what are your views on this question?
Hello.
Okay. Thanks, Karen. It's actually a similar type of orientation in South Africa as with Ghana. We see the central body, in this case, Department of Planning, Monitoring and Evaluation, as an executive support unit, primarily focused on the priorities the broad priorities of the administration. Now, government has to function irrespective of whether there is new administration or old. So there is what then becomes the sustained agenda, like managing budgets and making sure that services are delivered, policing happens and all of that. So then that becomes the work of other ministries to also embed monitoring and evaluation within their own work. It does happen implicitly sometimes, and it does happen explicitly. Where it's implicit, you will find quite good performing institutions that have strong information management systems, some auditing capacity and all of that. The only challenge there, you haven't brought the M&E thinking of being purposeful. You're not just keeping information, you are actually asking questions about performance, accountability, you're asking about results, the impact that you are making, which is the learning and reflection that the M&E thinking brings. So it's a balance of both. Also then recognize that whilst you might have a central agency that drives M&E directly, other role players that have transversal policy functions like the ministries of finance, even public administration, and some that are coordinating the intergovernmental agenda would play a role within the context of their own mandate. So a ministry that supervises local government, for example, would then need a more transversal type of capacity that is similar to the work done by the central unit. Hence then the concept of communities of practice becomes important, because that's where you journey together. As you journey, you define your roles and responsibility, compare notes. There will be a degree of turf war sometimes, and that's the reality. But it's really a balance of both. So we conceptualize the broader monitoring and reporting as a management practice. So every manager who manages a program have to then design those indicators, measure performance and all of that. But then evaluations, especially large evaluations, it's advisable that they are really strategic and selected in a strategic way, like Uganda is doing, to evaluate those major programs of government so that you inform then policy and decision making at the highest possible level in within the state. So an evaluation, a centralized evaluation capacity is extremely important, because then even within terms of costs, you can see the impact you're making, and because those are prioritized, and rather than having too many that are competing. Not that evaluations mustn't be conducted everywhere else as a culture, it is important that they do take place. But that's where the central central unit becomes crucial. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Stanley. I'll now put a question to Timothy, which came in on the chat. And that's on creating demand for evaluation by parliaments. You mentioned your committee in Parliament on budgeting, but can you tell us a bit more about the journey of creating demand for evaluations by parliaments? What's your experience in building this demand? And after Timothy, I'm going to ask Stanley to come in as well, because I believe he also mentioned parliaments. So Timothy first.
Thank you, Karen, and thanks to Wami. I think it is Semblewenge Wami. Forgive my pronunciation. Who raised the question? So very, very quickly. For us, it has been a long journey, and so we have worked with our collaborative networks, including IDEV at the Africa Development Bank, where Karen works. But also CLEAR, the Center for Learning relying on evaluations and research based at Wits University in South Africa. With Twain Dembele, the program that sponsored this webinar, and also with other networks, including 3IE, that's the International Initiative for Impact Evaluation. And we have engaged Parliament in several ways. We have undertaken training programs with them. We have interested them in understanding our developments in improving the evaluation function in Uganda. And we even formed a parliamentary interest group on evaluations. So we have, over the years, had a series of activities. We involved them in our national M&E events. We sponsor some parliament to M&E activities. So it's been a lot of work to engage them, to increase their interest, but also to develop their capacity to appreciate the use of evidence. I think that's what I want to say. But I also, in 1 minute, Karen, I see you are running out of time. There are other comments I saw. A number of students are grateful. It's been informative. That is good to know. There's a question on demand, if you accept. Renata says, donor demand, how is that useful in promoting the evidence evaluations in the country? So this is this serves two ways. The first is that actually donor demand can increase supply, increases supply and increases demand for evaluations, because then there is interest to have more interventions that are funded by government and also with donors evaluated. But there is also a risk that it can lead to the country is not investing in evaluations and leaving it as a donor thing, which is a problem that we have faced in the past. And it's also affecting many countries. From my experience in Twain Dembele, I know that. So you need, beyond that donor demand, you need a national champion, you need a national cadre of interested people, champions, who are going to drive and interest the country so that from the national budget, you have locally generated leadership and interest in developing this function. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Timothy, and thank you for bringing in that additional question as well. Stanley, on Parliament?
Thank you. In our case, we realized about 12 years ago that Parliament needed more support on understanding M&E and using it. So the approach was to either bring expertise from places like World Bank to share global experiences so that this can be seen as not something just in South Africa. It happens everywhere and it works. And we even took some parliamentarians on study tours to Kenya and Uganda, where we saw good experiences of how evaluations were actually linked directly to the debates in parliament and even budget decisions. And we then assisted in establishing a budget office, which is the technical capacity that's already there in Kenya and Uganda and in other countries like Canada and the US. So what has happened has really been very good, because there is more demand than we can supply. As I said on the presentation, there is a tendency to want to know what evidence can you share with us that shows us that these policies and laws that we are making here are actually being implemented. So the management performance assessment tool came in handy in that regard, because then it begins to talk to questions of implementation of rules and regulations. And the second one would be just performance information, quarterly performance information about institutional performance and all of that. So if a system that works is the same system that gets audited, and so parliamentarians do like that. But the more you give information, the more deeper questions come, when then the evaluations come in handy, when they start asking hard questions about value for money, investment, return on investment, whether we really making a difference on the ground. then evaluations become very, very useful. And unfortunately, I can say that the demand is always higher than supply, given the nature of evaluations that we do. There's also a question on the notice board that asks about the agile capacity building. What I meant there is we have realized that it's important to have the traditional training that you would have either run by private sector and universities, which is standardized and it would happen for quite many years. The agility comes when you're dealing with empowering either administrative leaders or political leaders to actually use evidence to ensure that there is an incentive. Those are not people that would be keen to sit in a class for a long time, most of the time. So you have to then find ways and means that either involve them in problem solving situations, including webinars now could serve very well, that like I'm a different person now having listened to colleagues sharing their experiences here. So they are unintrusive, but very much in the space of saying, other people are doing this and it works. And there is some work then that's being done through Twendembele, for example, on evidence-based policymaking and training, which then helps with the instruments of that nature. So I'm saying the field is open for even other ways and means that colleagues can suggest that try to respond to the reality of our environment right now. Thank you.
Thank you, Stanley. And what you're saying about there is more demand than we can supply is something I recognize very much as well. We also at the AFDB, we are faced with a lot of demand for accountability, evidence of performance, as you say, value for money, making a difference on the ground. So indeed, it's clear that evaluation is demanded and is appreciated by different audiences. Okay, I'm just going to indulge, I'm going to request your indulgence for to give Andrew 2 more minutes to answer the question on champions, and then we will close. So Andrew, there was a question on, or you said that having a champion is one of the fueling aspects as a precondition for using M&E information. Can you talk about the process of building and onboarding those champions in Ghana, especially if the champion is a high-level government official? What worked well in Ghana to have a champion?
Yeah, thank you, Karen. I think in our case, we've been very lucky to have had a minister who was in the earlier government of the current party in power, actually was a deputy minister of finance. And then unfortunately, the finance minister passed on, he served as an interim finance minister and, built some reputation within government. So I guess if my calculation is that the current president wanted to tap into his experience and so decided to hand him the M&E portfolio and made him a member of cabinet as well as a member of the economic management team. And it's been quite instructive in the sense that, there are a lot of sensitivities surrounding M&E. And if you have a minister who doesn't command enough respect among his colleagues, it could be a real problem. And so you need a champion who is respected within the rank of cabinet and but has an approach which is non-threatening. Because, you have very powerful ministers with big envelopes, spending envelopes, and who is the M&E minister to tell them what to do and what not to do? So you need that level of leadership, someone who's able to pull his colleagues along with him. And I think our minister has done that most effectively. And because of that, actually, some commentators have gone public to say that, oh, the ministry is not, you know, is, you know, to put it mildly, is not effective, because their understanding of Ministry of Monitoring and Evaluation, I believe, was a ministry that could go around and make, you know, certain pronouncements, you know, about who is doing well and who is not doing well. You know, sort of a policing function, but our ministry didn't position itself that way. And I mean, in fact, and the minister too. So it's a balancing act. And so, yeah, you need the leadership to carry messages to cabinet gently. And since our minister sits in cabinet, is, you know, he's able to bring certain evidence to the table. Because when we prepare our reports, annual progress report, which is color-coded, we try to identify some cross-cutting issues that, you know, can be that affect all the ministries. So then he presents his the report to cabinet, and then these issues are discussed. So I think without that kind of leadership, the work of the ministry would have been difficult. I hope I've done justice to the question. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Andrew. And indeed, that also resonates with what Stanley was saying about the need to adapt your approach to your target audience. If this is what the minister has found to be most effective in Ghana, it may be, you know, it may work there, it may not work in other countries, but that is why each country develops its own approach and its own system. So we're coming to the end of this webinar. I want to thank our speakers, Andrew from Ghana, Timothy from Uganda, and Stanley from South Africa. I want to thank Parfait and Amanda from the Twende Mbele Secretariat for making this webinar possible. And I want to thank all of you participants for taking part, for your attention, and for putting your questions to our presenters. The webinar has been recorded. The recording will be made available to you, as well as the PowerPoint presentations that were projected on the screen. They will be sent to the registered participants in the webinar. So thank you again for participating, and we hope to see you again at another Twende Mbele webinar soon in the future. So keep well, everybody.